Find that on page 186 in your pew Bibles. Again, it's 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 5. I believe that's on the screen as well. Let me read that for you. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last day. Let's pray. Lord, as we gather together here today, I thank you that your presence is here with us. Lord, I pray for an increase of your Holy Spirit to just pour into each of us and help us to tap into that tangible presence of God with us. That is your name, one of your names, Jesus, Emmanuel, which means God with us. So, Lord, help us to know that, to comprehend that, and to live in that. And, Lord, as I speak forth here, let it not be my words or my thoughts, but your words and your thoughts. For your thoughts are higher than my thoughts, your ways higher than my ways. And that's what brings life. And that's what you desire to give to us through your grace and goodness and mercy. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. So what comes to mind when you think of the word hope? Maybe wishful thinking? The dictionary defines hope as a feeling of expectation or a desire for something to happen, a feeling of trust, or actively waiting for something to happen or to be the case in your life. Each Christmas, there seems to always be that one or two must-have toys. In the 80s, it was the Cabbage Patch Kids and Transformers and Crush Balls. I think there's a picture of those up there. And the 90s saw electronic games take over. Game Boy, Nintendo, Xbox. But there was still the occasionally stuffed toy that snuck in there, like Beanie Babies. And who can forget Tickle Me Elmo? If you did get one of those, you probably were a terrible parent by some people's or children's imagination. Children setting their hope on receiving that special gift, thinking it will bring happiness. Children that do not receive that desired gift or receive the consequence of unfilled happiness or hope immediately. The children that do receive the hope for a toy will begin with that satisfaction of fulfilled hope. Yet, it will likely be but a short time before that satisfaction wears out, and they find themselves in the same place of unfulfilled hope as the child that never received the toy to start with. Hope placed in the things of this world are fleeting and temporary at best. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 5 direct us to place our hope in our inheritance in Jesus Christ, an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. The inheritance that is kept in heaven for us. As disciples of Jesus Christ, we are born into that living hope that has been secured for us through Jesus' resurrection from the dead, guarded and protected for us by God, and it's a better inheritance than all the gold in four counts. Hope placed in that which is eternal never changes, and it inspires and builds trust within us. With a growing trust comes the ability and the freedom to hope for more, or to hope for greater things, or even with greater expectation, to see what you hope for fulfilled and see it come to fruition. Now compare this to the hope for a gift of a child. Whether received or not, the result was the same: disappointment and broken expectation. And the more this pattern is repeated in a person's life, the desire to hope decreases and can lead to hopelessness. Fear of disappointment increases and negatively influences our future thoughts, decisions, and decisions and desires. Now, I use this example of a child and desire gift as a simple illustration of what happens in our day-to-day relationships with each other. Though the hopes and expectations are different, the results can be very similar when it doesn't go well. When promises are made, we anticipate that they will be kept. Someone tells us that they will do something, and we believe them. We trust them to be faithful to their word. Hope rises up in us to see accomplished what has been promised. And we are connected to the promise giver and to the promise through that hope of seeing accomplished what was promised. If this is our first encounter with this particular person, our memory slate will be clean, and we will, with a clean memory slate, we will tend to expect success. We will tend to trust the person to be true to their word. Now, if the person keeps their word and does what was promised, completes the task, as we are actively hoping to see it completed or accomplished, our hope is satisfied. And the hope for result is fulfilled in our lives. And a positive result is written upon our memory slate. Trust has increased between the two parties that are involved. And now if affirmation and appreciation are shared between the two people, if we speak words of gratitude and thanksgiving to the person between us, then there's a greater capacity for mutual trust and hope to develop between you. And this is the everybody wins situation that God desires for us in our interpersonal relationships with each other. So do you like to see others win when you win? God certainly does. That's his desire for us. So what happens if the promised word is not kept? The task is not completed, or is completed poorly. Hope is not fulfilled. Trust between the parties is violated and dealt a blow. There is a break in the relationship between the two parties. When hope is not fulfilled and trust is broken, relationships get hurt. The seriousness of the break and the hurt depends on what happens next after that. And here are a couple scenarios of what could happen in that situation. The parties could choose to ignore the hurt and go on as if nothing happened. The problem is that hurt did happen. And ignoring the problem does not heal the hurt or the brokenness. One or both parties could lash out at each other. Retaliation may feel good in the moment, but it only furthers the hurt and the deep in each person. Now, one of the parties could approach the other to initiate dialogue in hope of resolving the hurt and building a bridge across that hurt and brokenness. Now, if rejected, the hurt and the break will only get deeper and wider. If accepted, the hurt can begin to heal, can be the beginning of building a bridge across that break. Now, when both parties accept responsibility and are actively involved to restore trust, to heal the hurt, to mend the break in the relationship, hope can once again blossom to expect the best in each other. Now, we are commanded by God to love one another. There are no exceptions. Yes, even Packer fans. However, trust is not a gift. Trust must be earned. Trust has come through restoration and through interpersonal skills and working together. And restoration is never an easy work, but the consequences of not doing it are far worse. Yet, restoration is always necessary because in our interactions, there will be mistakes and there will be misunderstandings. Mistakes only become failures when we do not learn from our mistakes. A mistake can be a learning opportunity. There are a few times in parenting as powerful as when a parent acknowledges a mistake that they have made. They go to their child, they admit their mistake, and apologize without making excuses. It speaks loud and clear to the child that they are valuable and important. And as a parent, I can speak from experience on that. It's never been easier. I never liked doing that. But God prompted me to the point that I couldn't say no. And when I went to one of our children and apologized for a mistake I made, of course, the child is going to forgive you. Their hearts are always open to that. And it restored the relationship and brought us into greater intimacy between child and parent. Now there are restoration. Let's look at that. Restoration is not possible by our own strength. Restoration is only possible because of the living hope that we have in Jesus Christ. For it is through Jesus' earthly birth, which we are about to celebrate at Christmas, Jesus' sin-free life, Jesus' sacrificial death on the cross, and Jesus' glorious resurrection from the dead, that the way has been made for us to be reconciled into a relationship with God for all eternity. And because of that restoration with God, we are enabled to be reconciled to each other as well. In the text for today, Peter is writing to a church that is facing extreme persecution from the government of their day. Hope is a theme that winds through this entire epistle of Peter. Peter is writing to encourage the church to press on and to not be distracted by what's happening around them, to keep their eyes fixed on the eternal hope that they have in Jesus Christ. Peter writes, "You have been born again into a living hope. You are no longer of this world, even though you are in the world." And this is not just any hope, but a hope that has been secured through the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. A living hope, an inheritance that is imperishable. An inheritance that is undefiled. An inheritance that is unfading, kept in heaven for us. Now, throughout Scripture, we see a balance between the sovereignty of God and the responsibility of mankind. The Bible teaches both truths. God is sovereign. Mankind must respond. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4 address the sovereignty of God in our passage today. We are born again by God into a living hope by resurrection of Christ, Jesus Christ from the dead. And our inheritance in heaven is established by God, imperishable, undefiled, unfading. It's reserved in heaven with your and my name on it. Protected for you and by God, protected for each of us. And this is all God's work. It's all done, God's work done on our behalf. We have no part in providing this inheritance. So what is our part? Believing and receiving. God has done all the rest. He didn't leave any of the work up to ones as weak as you and I. So all that is left for us to do is to believe the work of God, and let God work it in us and through us by the Holy Spirit. And this is summed up for us in John chapter 6, verses 28 and 29. Then they said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." The work that God would have us to do is to believe in his Son, Jesus Christ, whom he sent to rescue us, to place our current and eternal hope in the promises of God and not in ourselves or what we can do. All that matters in life is yes and amen in Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Lord, I thank you that you have gone before us and made a way where we could not make a way. You have made straight the path and invite us to come and to walk with you, to join you, to be with you at all times. Lord, thank you that you are always available to us. So Lord, just bring healing to each of us in any areas where hope has been broken, where trust has been damaged in our past. Help us to be reconciled to the hurt, to turn it over to you, to forgive where we need to forgive, to confess what needs to be forgiven, to confess, and trust you for the results in that. Thank you that your grace is sufficient for us, no matter where we are, what we're doing, or what we are about. Bless us now as we go forth, that your name would be high and lifted up, that we would live in that living hope that we've been born into through your Son, Jesus Christ. For it is in his precious name that we pray. Amen. Amen.